This is the Dual XC4100 car stereo. As far as I can tell, it is the last new car radio you can buy today with a cassette player. It's been on the market for quite a long time, over a decade, but you can still buy these new. I got this one for $26 with free shipping on eBay. It was new in the original box. It advertises 30 watts of power. That's both channels combined, so that's 15 watts maximum per channel. It's a two-channel amplifier. And on the bottom here, it says the actual rating is 4 watts RMS per channel at 4 ohms, which is about the same as a typical factory base-level car radio. Also has an aux input, as they show it being hooked up to an iPod there. And it has RCA preamp outputs. Of course, as you can see, it's a manual tuner, so it's nothing too fancy. But this model is especially popular with people with vehicles from the 60s, 70s, and 80s, which are designed for a shaft-style radio, where you get a cutout in the middle for the faceplate and two holes for the knobs. So if you don't want to cut up your dashboard to accept a more modern radio, this is one of the few you can use that will fit in the existing cutout in your dashboard of an older vehicle. There is also a model by the Pyle company that is a shaft-style radio, but instead of a cassette player, it has an SD card slot and a USB port for playing MP3 files and things like that. But from what I've seen and heard about that model, it's very, very cheap and doesn't really work that well. Well, the reviews of this one are actually pretty positive. Features are a cassette player of auto-stop, so it's not auto-reverse or anything like that. It's a very, very basic cassette player. DIN or two-shaft compatible chassis, one pair of preamp outputs, front panel aux input, 3.5 millimeter, rotary-controlled AM-FM tuner, stereo mono selector for FM, and also an LED that lights up when you have it set to FM, locking fast-forward for the cassette player, tone and balance controls. Well, from what I can see on the unit itself, there is no tone control. You do get a balance control on this one, though, and a bass boost button. The back of the owner's manual lists the specifications, and they're pretty bad. Cassette player frequency response 60 Hz to 6.3 kHz. I don't know how they're measuring that, because I've played cassettes on this thing, and the high end is definitely going a lot higher than 6 kHz. Maybe not as good as a good quality cassette player, but it's listenable. FM tuner tuning range, the normal FM band pretty much. Frequency response 30 Hz to 13 kHz, which is pretty reasonable for a cheap radio. AM tuner is 530 to 1710 kHz. Frequency response 80 Hz to 2 kHz. Again, I don't know how they're measuring that. They're probably not using any NRSC preamplifiers, because I've listened to AM stations on this, and the high end is definitely going a lot higher than 2 kHz. At night, you can even hear the 10 kHz carrier whistle when you have a station right next to the station you're listening to. Power supply 11 to 16 volts, negative grounds. Amplifier is designed for 4 ohm speakers. You also get a voltage output for a power antenna, or if you're using an external amplifier, you can use this as the turn-on signal. Otherwise, the hookups are very simple, just positive and negative 12 volts. Doesn't even need a separate terminal for the battery and ignition because it doesn't have any memory backup. There's the RCA outputs for the preamp, and you get your speaker outputs left and right, which I just have hooked up to a couple test speakers here on my workbench. And this little thing here is what I have hooked up to a ground. And then there's the standard Motorola type antenna connector, which I have a little antenna from a scanner plugged into it. And then I have a couple clip leads connected to my shelves here to use that as the antenna. And 12 volt gel cell battery. So here's the unit itself. It comes pre-assembled like this, so you don't have to put together the faceplate and the knobs if you're going to put it in a more modern car. But you can remove the faceplate and the knobs if you have an older car and then install it into a dashboard that only has this kind of cutout in the middle. So anybody who grew up in the 70s and 80s probably already knows how to use it. You just get your on off and volume here. This is your tuning, and your balance is this little collar here. It's kind of cheap that this looks like it could be another control, but it's just fixed together with the volume control. It would be nice if they actually had a tone control like it lists on the box, and that would be perfect for the tone control, but it doesn't have that. There's your AM-FM band switch, mono stereo switch for FM, and a bass boost button, which, unless you have very good speakers, you probably just want to leave it on all the time. Here's your fast forward and eject button for the cassette. Here's the cassette door and the aux input. So let's turn it on. This is AM band right now. So this is a very sensitive tuner. That's a low power 10 watt station from about 10 miles away, and it's picking it up.
Experience the organic juice cleanse for yourself. You try it, you be the judge.
Open for Crystal's ultimate.
Is that polka music? It's even picking up polka music. Not sure what station that is. Maybe something from Connecticut.
City to develop European fund finance platform in the U.S., including providing customized lending facilities to funds and entities which manage and control the funds.
So that high end is definitely going a lot higher than 2 kilohertz, like the specifications say. It's not quite the full NRSC bandwidth, but it's not too bad.
Breathless.
So even music is listenable on AM on this thing. Let's try FM.
Morning, Elaine Ellis up in the Bronx.
You see, receive now. Look. I'd be good something.
So the FM tuner is very sensitive as well. And if you have a noisy signal like that, you can switch to mono mode to clean it up. And I can't let you go. So I've been very pleasantly surprised by the performance of this tuner. I thought it would just be an afterthought, because most people are going to buy this so they can plug their iPod into it. That's really what they figure most people would be using it for, but the tuner is actually very good. My only real complaint is that the tuning knob is only this little part of it. This collar is all the balance control. They could have made this a lot smaller so that you can get more finger grip area on this knob here. It was also very stiff when I first started using it, but it's loosened up a little bit after I've gone back and forth across the band a couple times. It's not easy to just crank it all the way from one end of the band to another. So if you're a preset hopper, this radio is not for you. But if you just like one or two stations and you leave it on one station for a long time, it'll be perfectly fine. Very good tuner. Unlike that Pyle radio that has the same kind of cutout and has the SD card slot. I've heard a lot of complaints about the tuner on that one. But this one is very good.
New Jersey 101.5! New Jersey time, 11:48. It's Big Joe Henry living large at Love of Life.
And it sounds very good too, especially if you have the bass boost turned on. Would have been nice if they gave you at least a treble control, but it's okay. I just have these little Radio Shack RCA speakers here, and the dial is lighted when you have the radio on. So let's try the cassette player. The side you want to play is facing up, so you just stick it in. It sort of goes in at an angle, and then you lock it into place. Notice the dial light goes out when you're playing a tape. But I'm gonna make a mind. You can see the tape moving in there. If you want it fast forward, you just lock it in halfway. If you want to eject, you just push this button all the way. And you can flip it over, play the other side here. So if you hold it in just a little bit, you can get a cue effect where you fast forward, but you can still hear what's going on.
And you hung around and bothered me every night. And when I wouldn't go out with you, you said things that weren't very nice. My boyfriend's back and you're gonna be in trouble.
I'll ever see the light. Vegas. Monopoly Millionaires Club. Making more.
So when it reaches the end of the tape, it shuts off the motor and switches to the radio, but you can see the tape is still locked into place, so you really should eject it. And finally, to test the aux input, I don't have an iPod with me right now, but I do have a camcorder with music on it. So you just plug in your cable here, and it switches off the radio and switches automatically to the input. So I should be able to start the music playing here. That seems to work just fine. It's not really much you can do with it. You just get the volume control and the bass boost button, and that's it, and the balance control. If you want to switch back to radio, you just unplug it. There's a look inside the cassette player. Most of the mechanism is made of metal. If you look back there, there's a trim pot, but I don't know if that's the antenna trimmer. I know back in the 70s and 80s, some radios would have an antenna trimmer, and you would open up the cassette door and stick a screwdriver in, and that would match the tuner to the length of your antenna, but the manual for this makes no mention of that, so I don't know. I don't think that's the antenna trimmer. I think it's just set to a fixed value.
KSON FM 97.3.
So that's the Dual XC4100 car stereo. It's not high fidelity, high power, or high quality by any means, but for under $30, you really can't complain. and it has the advantage of fitting into the dashboard of classic cars and trucks. And I believe it's the very last new car radio you can still buy today with a cassette player.